Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Master's Touch. The Master's Touch Bible study. You thought we were going to play music tonight, and we are in a little while. We're happy that you're wishing us well. Thank you. I'm so glad that you're coming on and letting us know that you're listening and you're joining us for Bible study. Even if you end up in the archives, that's great. It's good news. And I'd just like to invite you to not hesitate, if you are live with us or you're on Spreaker, to go on and send us a question. Send us an email question. I get them both, and we'll bring them up and discuss them as we go tonight, all throughout our study. Now, we're excited to delve into the Word of God with you again this week as we get a better understanding of the Word and who we are in Christ and God's purpose in our lives. But before we take a quick roll call tonight, I just want to take this opportunity to welcome Joanna Moran to our group. Joanna is my sister in Christ and has been my friend for many, many years. And Joanna has a call on her life for sharing the Word of God, and I know that you'll enjoy the perspective that she brings to our study. Hi, Joanna.
Hello, Steffi. Hi, Karen. Hello, Sharon.
And Joanna.
Hi.
Now for our roll call. I'm Dr. Stephanie Angerbritzen, Chancellor, Director of Ministry, Professor, and Senior Pastor of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. And next, whoever's going next.
I'm Pastor Karen Weitzman with Refuge of Hope Healing Ministry. I love to counsel. I'm a pastoral counselor for those who are suicidal and depressed. And I also am a healer. We're going to be talking about the healing Word of God tonight. So I'm also a healer that loves to help people who have chronic illness and help them restore them back through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I'm Pastor Sharon, and my ministry is Under Grace Ministries. I have a blog and a prayer ministry. Giving everything that the Lord gives me as He gives it to me to share His love and His grace.
Amen.
And I am Tiffany. I am the layperson advocate of this group, and I actually will be leading the group tonight on our subject.
All right.
So go ahead, Steph.
Okay. Thank you. Now, folks, we meet here online over Skype every Monday evening at 6 p.m. Pacific time. And if you can't make the meeting, we broadcast it on Spreaker.com, and we archive it there and on our website, themasterstouchhs.org. And it can also be found on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and Google+. So we're out there for you, and we invite you to come and study with us. Our Bible study is kind of weird. Not really. It's very casual. Extremely so. So get comfy, kick off your shoes, curl up with your Bible and a pen and paper and your snacks, and be sure to share. Today, Tiffany Whittington is leading our Bible study, so I'll be turning the program over to her in just a minute. But my friends, we know that the door to God's throne room presence is open through soaking in worship. So right now, soak with us.
I see.
Praise the Lord. Wow. I've been asked to open us in prayer tonight, so my friends, let's pray. Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving flowing from our hearts and our lips. We praise you, love you, and adore you. We thank you for bringing us together to study your word and to learn more and more about you. We want a deep, rich, and intimate relationship with you. And we thank you for the opportunity to develop a greater understanding and love for you, your Son, and his Holy Spirit as we grow in Christ. Lord, it's our desire that you bless our listeners with revelation, knowledge, your wisdom and understanding, and that this gathering will spark a hunger and thirst for you and your word that is insatiable. Lord, it's your living water that we gather here to drink as we study your word and delve more deeply into you. We praise and thank you for blessing each one of us with an anointing for the gift of utterance, revelation, knowledge, impartation, and a deep and rich intimate relationship with you. May our words be your words, Lord, and your words be ours, and may we all be blessed with a greater understanding of you and your word as our words continually glorify you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Listen, my friends, did you come expecting to receive from God tonight? If not, you won't receive anything from him, so elevate your expectation level, and you will come away with a greater head and heart knowledge and a better understanding of God's word. Tiffany?
Well, thank you very much. And before we begin our study this evening, I want to start with taking communion. None of us are actually prepared. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Yes.
My whole picture changed here. Wait a minute. I want to make sure I have.
Well, you're all right with us. We can hear you.
Okay. Okay. I'm sorry. Everything goes nuts at once. We haven't started our program yet with taking communion, and I kind of sprung it on everybody tonight because I want to express it in a little bit different way. None of us are sitting here prepared to actually have the normal elements that we're used to and associate with taking communion. So I want to remind you that communion is an intimacy with God and Jesus and the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me as often as you would like. So we're going to take communion now in a strange way that none of you are used to. We're going to pretend that we have those elements. And as we take the elements, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to visualize Jesus sitting right here with us and him breaking the bread and handing it to you. And you take it and you eat it. And likewise, the same with the cup. If you need to bring yourself into his presence because of some chaos or problem or an emergency, taking communion will put you at his side as he ministers to you. This is not a religious traditional ritual. This is a true experience of his presence and his healing power. So now would you join me, please, and close your eyes and visualize that. It is written in Matthew 18:20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. Father, we ask now humbly and in faith that as we take this bread, you will open our hearts and our minds so that we hear your words and know that you are real and that we are always aware that you are with us in all things. In the name of Jesus the Christ, take the bread. Knowing that it is for our healing that you gave us that at the cross. Now take the cup, thanking God for his promises and covenants and for our salvation in the name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to share this with you because oftentimes when we're ministering someplace out in the street, for example, and I spent a lot of years in the healing ministry in the streets with homeless people, sometimes the only connection that they're going to have with Jesus and his healing power is through us, and God is working through us then. Learning how to move out of the tradition of having to take communion only once a month, and with all the elements and everybody praying over them and the solemnity of it all, taught me that sometimes we have to be ready on a dime, so to speak, to be able to take communion with somebody. Even though it's a pretending sort of thing, it becomes real when you see it in your mind. When you put your mind and your heart in the space of God and of Jesus, he knows what's in your heart, and he's there. He's there. Because the communion itself is for remembrance, to bring him closer and closer into us. I'm really excited about being here tonight and starting with this study on the holy healing power of God. It's truly a wonderful, awesome thing. First, I want to start off with by making a distinct definition of the word healing. It's to make healthy, whole, or sound, to restore health free from ailment, to bring an end or a conclusion to conflict between people or groups. And defining the power. Power is the ability or the capacity to do something. The capacity or ability to direct or influence the behavior of others or a course of events. So, might we say here then that the healing power of God technically is God's ability to influence behavior and make it whole, healthy, and restored. Mm-hmm. The emphasis tonight is on how we see the healing power of God. We are all wounded in some fashion or way or another, and at some time or another in our mind, our soul, or our body. And we need our broken part to be fixed. This is where God's presence and his guidance is needed to restore us and make us whole again. So we begin then to seek a way to do that. We delve into the Word of God to find a method to do that. Each one of us tonight will be sharing our concept of what the healing power of God is. And as we share that, I'm sure that all of us can relate to each situation as it's explained to us. I'm going to start off with John 10:10. John 10:10. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. And from Acts 10:38, he went about doing good. And that he, of course, is referring to Jesus. So now I'd like to ask you to ask yourself, how do I see the healing power of God? How do I see it? The word describes it to me clearly in Philippians 4:8. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. So look around you. Everywhere you go, every place you are, you can literally see, the healing power of God at work in your life. You only need to take a millisecond to actually see it. Make yourself totally aware of the healing power of God by seeing obviously different things. There is healing in his music, for example. When you hear beautiful music and lyrics, think a moment on the rest and the pleasure that it brings to you and how it soothes your troubled mind and your wounded spirit. It also physically will relax you. That's healing. The common things, everything we look at, everything we're exposed to, if we begin to peel away the negative and fill it with positive, you're going to see healing power, of the magnificent healing power of God in it. There is healing in random acts of kindness. Think on the powerful benefits that you received and the healing of your emotional state when someone unexpectedly gives you a compliment. simple. Gosh, your hair is great. Wow, that shirt looks really good on you. You have a really great smile. Hey, your mom is awesome. Thank you, sir, for jump-starting my car today. Hey, thanks for helping with the dishes tonight. Thanks for explaining my medication. This list of kindness can go on and on and on. From Ephesians 4:32, and this one's really close to my sister and I, be ye kind unto another. My grandma used to say that every day, 40,000 times, when she heard Steph and I arguing as kids, she would stop and go, be ye kind one to another. And, you know, we used to even laugh
at it. Mock her. Yeah.
All right, here it comes again, you know. But in truth, if you look at kindness for what it truly is, reaching out to your fellow man, brother, sister, whatever, another believer, that kindness can be a huge healing balm to their spirit. They could be having a horrible day. They could be having some really awful, traumatic something happening in their life. And if you just stopped 1 second and said, wow, you look great today, you know, everything else goes away. Suddenly you're like, oh, wow, do I? Oh, it's a very obvious healing type of a situation, even though it's minute and little. Anyway, Ephesians 4:32, be ye kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. These are the Lord's healing words of behavior to us. Forgiveness is healing to both the forgiven and the forgiver. When you have wronged someone and wounded someone's soul, and that person says, I forgive you, and he puts it behind him, and he puts those feelings of doubt and despair away, recall then how you felt and the joy that you received in your emotions and in your whole physical being, because you're tense and distraught over stuff, when that person actually forgave you. It just sort of lifted your spirits completely and moved you into a totally different space. Those are healing instances. Things that we so overlook every day, every single day. Those are the common things that God and Jesus have put out there and, in essence, commanded us to do that we don't see. We don't even think about it. We just go about our work, and, you know, and do whatever we're doing, and so that other person is there, so what? So you're out on the road, and some guy pulls out in front of you, oh, well, so what? Now, obviously, you can't roll down your window and yell, hey, I forgive you for doing that, you creep.
Why not?
But in your mind, you can. And in your heart, you can go, okay, God, I'll let go. I'll let go. I forgive that guy. It's not that big of a deal. And you move forward. And what really is happening is a healing process. And every time you do that, your inner man, your heart, your soul starts to build more confidence. And you get a stronger and closer and more intimate feeling with God, because that's what he wants us to do, be like him. I can't imagine any experience that Jesus ever had where he, other than chasing the money changers out, where he actually showed anything but kindness and compassion to some other person. Whether he was wronged or not, he always showed that. It's not the easiest thing to do. I'm not going to say that. It takes work. It takes a daily awareness. You have to put yourself in that space so it'll happen, period. And when you forgive someone yourself who has done something horrible to you, said something awful about you, talked about you behind your back, said you were ugly or whatever, and you actually let go of that and give it to God, that burden, that guilt of I've done that, and you go to them and you say, I'm sorry, I forgive you, the release is healing. There's no, I can't think of another word that can possibly encompass the feeling that you're going to have of, oh my gosh, I was forgiven. And Colossians forgiveness is healing to both parties, and it washes your heart over. And Colossians 1:14 reminds us of that when it says, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. You have healing in forgiveness. That old cliche that takes place that most of us have heard before that says, take time to smell the roses, is also true of the healing power of God's handiwork. In the beauty of nature, in all our senses, they come alive when we see the waves of the ocean or a lake, the smell of jasmine or lilac, the sounds of breeze rustling through the trees, the touch of the fuzz on a cattail, the taste of a nasturtium, the frolicking of otters or the spouting of whales, singing of birds, buzzing of bees, the chatter of monkeys, the meowing of a kitten. Relaxation of all of our senses take over. Smiles and laughter and the healing power of God is then all around us because we've noticed those things. We've taken the time to see beauty in something, to see positive in something instead of negative, nasty, icky, yucky stuff. If we take that extra step every day and we look at something for the beauty in it, not only are we obeying God, but we're healing ourselves and we're healing someone else when we share those feelings with them and allow them to see them and express them also. Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, these are the things that you should think on so that you can see the awesome healing power of God. So, Pastor Karen, would you please share with us now what your conception of the healing power of God is?
Okay. I really enjoyed what you were telling me. I was just sitting there relaxing, thinking about everything you said and how healing your words were. I took the power of God and took it inwardly, not something external. And I said, I think the healing power of God is in the dunamis power of God within. The dunamis power of God within. So that pretty much points us to the Holy Spirit. Dunamis is the word in English that we got from dunamis is dynamite. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Dynamite. Remember the word, the person
that used to say that?
Dynamite. You know, dynamite. So we think that we have this dynamite power of God within as born-again believers. And the scriptures that I, do you want me to go on, Tiffany?
Yeah.
Do you want me to
leave?
Okay. Please. The scriptures that I had behind that was Acts 1:8, where Jesus told his disciples in the upper room, you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. So the Holy Spirit is the carrier of this dynamite power. Romans 8:11 says, if the Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit. Mm-hmm. Now he's talking about the same resurrection power that is in Jesus is in us now. And we don't tap into it most of the time, but we'll talk a little bit more about that down the road. This is not an external possession that could be brought, that can be bought or sold, but it's a living, abiding presence within every born-again, spirit-filled believer. So we're looking at this dunamis power of God within as a living, abiding presence. Remember, Peter said to the beggar at the temple, he was the beggar was looking for money, and he had his hand out. And Peter said, well, silver and gold have I none, but what I have, I'm going to give to you. Mm-hmm. And he said, he didn't pray for him. He just said, arise in the name of Jesus Christ. So he was using that power within, the Holy Spirit power within for the beggar to arise. This power that we have inside of each and every born-again believer exceeds the power of the enemy, exceeds it. And we harness this power, if you want to look at it like electricity, we harness it within us, and we release it by the spoken word, by the laying on of hands, by prayer, by the casting out of demons, by speaking in tongues, or by just normal prayer, not speaking in tongues, because speaking in tongues is the evidence of the Holy Spirit and the power within us. Luke 9:1-2 says, "Then he called his 12 disciples, and he gave them power and authority over all devils to cure disease, and he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick." So this is the promise that we have, every born-again believer. 1 Corinthians 4:20, "The kingdom of God is not in word, but in power." And we know that 2 Timothy reminded us that we should not have a form of godliness. We were talking about this, Pastor Steph and I, today in Living the Word, that many of the churches have a form of godliness and are not using the gifts of the power by the Holy Spirit. And so run away from that church.
Amen, amen.
if you are not encountering the power and the gifts of the Holy Spirit, run away as fast as you can.
I agree totally with that. Any other comments on her concept?
Oh, I agree 100%. I'm spot on, Karen. I'm really good.
But I think she had a good teacher.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh.
Okay. Pastor Stephanie, would you like to share one of your concepts, please?
Yes, I would. I chose, out of the five I picked, and I got it confused, but anyway, out of the five, I want to choose this one to start with, and I'm just going to say Holy Communion, and if you'll let me explain.
Right ahead.
Okay. When we take Holy Communion, we're partaking of the body of Christ, and he instructed us to do it with regularity so that we can be continually reminded that he restored and healed us, brought us into divine health and wholeness at the cross. No sickness, no disease can harm us nor touch us because we are born again. All right. We're made a new creature, a new species in Christ Jesus. Now we are fused together with Christ, and we have his DNA entwined in our own. We are born through Jesus the Christ, and as a result, we have become bone of Jesus's bone and flesh of Jesus's flesh. And then from then on, we're walking in the divine health of Jesus the Christ, not our own, because we are in this earth suit that is decaying on a regular basis, that's subject to the earth and the world this demonic atmosphere that we're in. So when we walk in divine health, we're walking in the divine DNA and health of Jesus Christ. He is now in us, and we are in him. Our evidence, Ephesians 5, verse 30, "For we are members of his body, of his flesh, and of his bones." Then 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, you know my favorite. I says verse 17, I'm going to do a different one. "In this union and fellowship with him, love is completed and perfected with us, so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment with assurance and boldness to face him." So because as he is, so are we in this world. This is speaking of Jesus, so put his name in there. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. Okay, let me ask you something. How is Jesus? He's perfect, full of divine health and wholeness, full of the vibrancy of life, able to do miracles, full of confidence in God and his word and in himself and what he's able to accomplish for God. As Jesus is, my friends, so are we in this world. Hallelujah, that belongs to you. Okay.
Amen.
Yeah, that's awesome. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any comments about that? Gosh, you guys are quiet. I'm going to make a comment about that, because that's one of the reasons why I wanted to do communion today, even in the pretend element. And when you're when you're by yourself, let's just go when you're by yourself. You've had a lousy day. Everybody's been mean to you. The dog bit you on the foot, and you just want to scream. You want to shut the door and go, what is the purpose? If you quietly sit in your car somewhere or a closet, someplace where there's nothing to disturb you, and you move into that spot, Father, I want to come into the throne room with you. I'm alone. I'm here by myself, and I need your assurance that you're there. Pretend then and speak those words, you know, in faith and in confidence that I'm taking those elements, because it is that intimacy that puts you right in his spot, right where he wants you, right in the arms of the Holy Spirit, so you can feel that calmness, you can feel his presence. It's magnanimous. I mean, you'll be so excited when you get through doing it that you can hardly stand it. I have a friend, and every day she calls me on the phone. I've known her for 22 years, and she calls about 7:30 in the morning every day, and we moan and groan or gripe, and we talk about what we're going to do, and then we fix our day by taking communion. Mm-hmm. And I can't express enough how awesome that healing power is. It starts you off on a level of expectancy and a level of healing in everything. Mm-hmm. I mean, healing doesn't just refer to I've got a cut in my arm or a broken foot.
That's right.
It, you know, or something awful growing inside. It's everything. It's your mind. It's your thinking. It's how you think. You need healing in that, because our human space down here puts us in broken spots constantly. So that's all I have to say.
Well, that's activating the mind of Christ. That's activating the mind of Christ. When you begin to put yourself in his place with him and let him take over, and then you can begin to operate in that mind of Christ.
Okay. Joanna, would you like to share something about your concept of the healing power of God, please?
Well, there is one thing on my mind, although I didn't come prepared because I told Steffi I would listen for my first time. But what came to my mind as you and Steffi were teaching was the word. There's healing in that word.
Amen.
And Jesus, of course, is the word. And and as you were speaking, I was reminded of the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. Mm-hmm. He makes me to lie down in the green pastures and leads me beside the still and quiet water. There he revives, refreshes, restores my soul." That's healing power. Mm-hmm. You know, in our mind, our will, and our emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And that one particular verse always meant a lot to me, that he restores my soul. He restores my soul. Mm-hmm. So that's what came to me while you were speaking. And and of course, Tiffany, as you were sharing your teachings with us, it came to mind the Lord's Prayer.
Hmm.
that we forgive
my trespasses.
My mind went
trespasses
on. That's fine.
It's perfect.
We forgive those who trespass against us.
Mm-hmm.
So, and of course, there's just far-reaching truths that reach out to every one of those lines. And as you said when we started, we could go on forever.
Yeah.
Just expounding on a verse or two of the word. But that's what came to my mind is you were.
That's really good. I like that.
That's very true.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, I was just making a comment. I said that I like that. That's really true, because the word of God is Jesus. You know what I mean? And so if you've got the word, you've got everything right there.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, you know what comes to my mind, Steffi, and I was just reading this today, and that all things come through faith, of course.
Yes.
We know that. All things do. Mm-hmm. And I was just reading today in Romans out of the Brian Sims, the Passion Translation, and it was saying in Romans 10:17, "Now faith is from Now, this is the Aramaic. Mm-hmm. Now, faith is from the hearing ear, and the hearing ear is from the Word of God.
Oh, cool. I love it.
In King James, it says faith comes from hearing and hearing by the Word of God. I always pondered about that translation. Uh-huh. For some reason, I hop around from one to the other. I can't seem to help myself, although I try. But it never happens. But when I read that, now faith is from the hearing ear, and the hearing ear is from the Word of God.
Amen.
I just thought that was...
That's really good. I like that translation because, you know, in the Greek, when you read it, it says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of Christos. And we are translating it as Theos, which is God. And of course, that would encompass everything that is even negative. And that is not the case. Christ is the bread of life. You know what I mean? And so consequently, when the original text says Christos, that means faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of Christ. And that's perfect with what you're just talking about. You know, with the hearing ear.
Well, you know, and I don't know if you know, well, all of the word works together.
Of course.
Because all of it is healing in one way or another. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when we know the scripture that all things work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. Well, you know... what comes to my mind there is that it is a healing. Mm-hmm. And I made a little note here today. I didn't make it to share it exactly, but it all ties in. That as man was formed from the dust of the ground, all the things that the enemy uses against us is being formed together for our good.
Amen.
And that is a creative miracle.
Yes, it is.
That is, and you see, there is healing in that too. Mm-hmm. Just knowing that whatever we face, the Lord is using everything that's coming against us. He's forming that together for our good, and that is a creative miracle.
Amen. Amen. That's great. I like it.
And I don't know if I should share this, but the Lord taught me that, because sometimes, you know, we'll know a scripture, but it's not revelation, but it's not really real. Mm-hmm. I saw him in his long robes, down on his knees, and just as he formed man from the dust of the ground, yes, he was forming everything together for our good.
Yes, amen.
And of course, when you see that, the revelation comes with
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm.
So, Lord, just brought that anew to my mind today for some reason, and I don't know. You know, if it's along this lesson is all about, but it's all healing.
That's right.
It does fit in. It fits in my head. It fits in with seeing good through evil stuff. All right. So I know that maybe sounds off there a little bit, but when you take the thought of the devil throwing a bunch of stuff at you, all right, he's constantly trying to interfere. If you turn that around to, you have to recognize first where it comes from. This is not coming from God. This is coming from an enemy somewhere. Mm-hmm. Those darts and arrows that he's throwing to continually confuse you and keep you in a state of mental chaos. If you recognize that and stop and see, and it came to me when you said that, Joanna, I could see then Jesus taking that dirt, which is, you know, dirt is yuck, in a sense, and forming it into, taking that awful and forming it into something good mm-hmm. and changing it by making my mind see it differently. Instead of it coming at me as a horrible something or other, it's like, you know, stop, because I only see the good. I see the stuff that Jesus wants me to see. So get out of my way, shove that over here, and look past the what into the who. Who is doing it? Well, this person is making a bad choice and allowing bad things to, jump out at you. And it was like, wow, I really saw God doing that. And thank you for that. I mean, because I hadn't looked at it like that. I'm like everybody else walking around down here. When the arrow starts running at me, sometimes I have to stop and turn around and go, wait a minute, you're not going to shoot. I'm not having it. Before I actually see it as, and I don't want to use this word loosely, as a test. Mm-hmm. I often think that sometimes the things we are allowed to walk through when we realize we're not walking through them alone, I don't have to take any of that. I choose to reject it. I choose to walk past it because I have Jesus' hand in my hand, and I don't have to walk through any valley of the shadow of death alone. And it isn't figuratively, I don't mean like I'm going to die from it in the sense of somebody's going to, shoot me with a bullet right then. It's the shadow of all the things that create death in our life.
Well, two things came to my mind as you were saying that. In fact, that very scripture about walking through the dark valley came to my mind. It was on my heart and mind, and then you spoke it. And two things come to my mind as you were speaking. And one was, he prepares a table before me in the face of my adversaries. That's the Rotherham translation. He prepares a table before me in the face of my adversaries. And then, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. As we walk through that dark shadow, the way Brian Sims translated that is that though his paths take me through the darkest valley, evil will never conquer me because he already has.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Amen.
He already did it. And he took it all at the cross. Our biggest problem in life, period, is not recognizing that it's already happened. Mm-hmm. And we're just here after the fact learning how to accept it. And if we don't want to accept the truth, then we're going to walk through that valley longer and longer and longer. And that 40 days is going to turn into 200 and another year and, and another crisis in our life because we refuse to accept that healing power that's around us all the time and change our thinking. It took me a long time, years actually, before, even after accepting Jesus and getting saved, it took me a long, long time to accept the fact that that I had some control over what I do. I have control over everything I do. The choice is mine. I can either be a creep or I can try to be a good guy and look the other way and see past the shadow into the truth of what God's trying to show me. Sometimes we like blame it on somebody else, pass the buck. It's your problem. You did it and you're going to pay. And if somebody doesn't come along and make you pay, then I'm going to make you pay.
I think it's a matter of learning God's ways and walking in them. And the word is very clear. So, if we always have that word ever before our eyes, well, in Proverbs where it says, my son, attend to my words,
right.
Incline your ear to my saying, let them not depart from before thy eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to all who finds them, and healing, healing to all our flesh. So when you see, there is the key right there, having that word ever before our eyes and walking in it. As we walk in that word, it becomes a part of us. We become a living word, and you see, and there is where the healing is. So, you know, you don't make it an exercise of the mind. It's knowing the word and walking in it, bottom line, end of the conversation. And you could go around reasoning this, reasoning that, why this, why that, and mm-hmm. it's just a matter of knowing the word and doing the word.
Mm-hmm.
Bottom line.
Amen. Good job. Love it.
I just had one more comment. Tiff and Pastor Stephanie, you were talking about communion and the healing properties of communion that we're actually, you know, when we take communion, I've given communion sometimes even online. We've had communion. And we're not only talking about the death of Christ, but we're imparting, when we partake of his body and partake of his blood, mm-hmm. we're imparting life into that person. I've had people who have been in pain, maybe the enemy fighting them also, and we've taken communion, and as you said, Tiffany, John 10:10, he came to bring life and life more abundantly. Well, we're actually reaching out to Christ, and he's bringing life into our bodies.
Amen.
Through communion service.
That's right.
And through the word of God.
Amen.
Impartation of life. Mm-hmm. And the word of God also.
That's right.
I agree with that totally. All right, Sharon, you're on.
I'm just thinking like, I'm taking tons of notes tonight. I'm soaking up.
Me too.
Well, I love everything that's being said, and I'm totally right where you are, Tiffany, and the healing and mind and emotion. It's interesting, Joanna, because I was listening to a sermon today, and I'm going through the book of Mark, and the healing power is right where Jesus, when he went to the synagogue, and he was telling them about, he was reading, and they said, who is this that he speaks in authority? Well, he was actually speaking the word, where usually they're used to hearing other people's opinions of the rabbis. They didn't really read the word per se. They were reading other people's comments, and so they never really heard the power of the word. And when the power of the word did hit, the darkness was shaking in the light, and that's when the demonic spoke up in that man, and he was in the synagogue. So it's the power of the word that, and it brought healing to that man. He got delivered. So it's pretty interesting how the power of the word itself, it's alive and it's active. So I really like mm-hmm. everything you're saying. I just had to comment on that. I have a hard time because I had so much fun with the Lord when you gave all those three questions to Tiffany. So mm-hmm. I don't really have a lot of comments, but I just have just the words that he gave me for each one, and a couple scriptures, and nothing really other than that. But can I share them?
Please. Or, go ahead.
Okay, so the first one that you sent out, you said, to respond to, I think the healing power of God is. And so I asked the Lord, and I heard the words, by his willing and able heart.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And so to get the scripture for that, Mark 1:40-41 is where the leper came to Jesus and he beseeched him, falling on his knees before him, saying, if you are willing, you can make me clean. And moved with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man and said, I am willing, be clean. So Jesus was willing to leave his throne. I guess I did make some comments. Jesus was willing to leave his throne. He was willing to lay his life down for us. This is his willing heart. His death on the cross, his resurrection shows his willingness and the ability to bring forth his healing in our spirits and our souls and our body. We see it in Isaiah 53:5, where it says, the word of God says, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, chastised for our peace that was upon him. And by his stripes, we are healed. So Jesus's willingness, he laid down his life so that we would have life.
Mm-hmm.
And, I have here the reason the Father loves us is that he says this in John 10:17. He says, the reason the Father loves me is that he laid down his life in order to take it up again. So no one took Jesus' life. He willingly laid it down. And that he's our good shepherd. Psalm 23 is, by the way, my favorite song ever. I love that. I love it. So Jesus is the same today as he was then. And so he's still willing. He's still able to heal you in your spirit, to bring you new birth. He's willing and able to heal your wounds of your soul, your mind's will and emotion. And he's willing and able to heal your infirmities.
Amen. I agree.
Sorry. Can we go to the next one, Tiffany?
Okay, no, wait. I want to talk about that willingness. You know, I think that was a revelation to me. I had not given one thought to his willingness to do all of that so that we had the healing. I know that sounds horrible, but shame on me for not seeing that. As a willing thing instead of just he did it, but he did willingly do it. And that's part, that's something we have to do. Willingly, like, start seeing all the healing power around us. Start actually recognizing it, but willingly looking for it instead of just, oh, well, if I see it, great. If I don't, I don't. But the willing heart, I love that. I love that, Sharon. That was awesome. Thank you. Thank you for that. Anybody want to comment on that?
No?
All right. Okay.
Well, I was just going to say that he said, if I had not, you know, if I don't go away and if I don't do with my willing heart what I'm going to do, I won't be able to send you the Holy Spirit. And it's almost like he said, and that's what you're going to need, my Holy Spirit, to be able to overcome in these end times.
I like,
so that's also showing his willing heart.
I like the part, quite frankly, that before he even came here, he was willing.
Yeah.
You know, that he was willing to hang up his deity and come down here to save us, to take our abuse. You know, I mean, hey, that says a lot. He's wonderful. I love him.
Even if you ask yourself, would I be willing to do that? Maybe for my kid, but I don't know about everybody else.
Especially all the nasty people that are out there.
Well, especially, the sinners. He came to do it for all of us, you know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In regard to what you were saying, too, about Jesus coming willingly. And of course, we've heard, we know the scripture that God so loved the world that he sent his son. Mm-hmm. Now we're talking about willingness, Steffi. You were,
yes.
Okay. I said one time to the Father, well, why didn't you go?
Did he answer you?
So I said, well, Lord, why didn't you go? Well, the answer came very quickly. Jesus wanted to reconcile the world to his Father. He wanted to. And the love between the two of them, you see, is beyond our comprehension. Mm-hmm. And I heard a testimony of a man who had access to heaven, you know, which is happening more now. And he saw Jesus going in and coming out of the throne room. Mm-hmm. And when Jesus would exit the throne room, he would look back like he wanted to be with the Father. He was exiting the throne room, but his heart was in there with his Father. So the exchange of love between the two of them, well, I know it's beyond our comprehension.
Mm-hmm.
But that just explains a little of it to me. I think Steffi has such a grasp on the love of the Lord. You know,
I don't know. I do know that if we could just get a hold of how much, I mean, if we could understand and the concept of how much God loves us, it would change our lives. It would change all the the futility of what we're going through on a daily basis when we plug through and sludge through this life that we're living down here, if we could just comprehend what God feels towards us. You know, I think I shared with you guys that when I was over at this church I was attending, and we used to go on Monday nights and meet, and we all pray. And I got, there were some steps up to the platform, so I was just kneeling on the steps because it was just easier for my knees. And I was talking to the Lord, and I said, Lord, just tell me what it is. Show me how you feel about the world, the way it is, the way we are here. You know, what we're all doing and in the world here. And he absolutely, completely flattened me. The power of God hit me really hard, and I laid flat on these inclined steps. And the pressure that was on me was excruciating. It made every bone in my body ache. Every muscle was like cramped up like Charlie horse. I couldn't breathe. And I was going, wait, I can't breathe. Enough already. I've had it. You know, uncle. Anyway, and he finally released me, but I thought, wow, be careful what you ask for. You're liable to get it, you know what I mean? But the impact that it had on me, I sat there and wept. It just, because I realized that he was agonizing because we ignore him, because of how we don't pay any attention to him. And we take his word and we twist it and turn it and make it fit our agenda. You know, instead of taking the word and living it according to what he's given us, which is so simple. We make it so hard, and it's so simple. It's just there for everyone, you know.
Stephanie, I'm interrupting you.
That's
but,
okay.
But he said, come to me as little children. Mm-hmm. How simple can that, how much simpler can that be?
I know. You know, I had a, that starts another story. I had gone to listen to another preacher, and he was, and it impacted me greatly because I always kind of had God out there somewhere. You're not near me, not with me. Even though I knew that Jesus was in me and the Holy Ghost lived within me, it was like, yeah, but, you know, hello, God, wherever you are, you know, and he was distant to me. And that the preacher talked about that particular scripture, Joe, and what he gave me was a vision of coming into his throne room as a little kid, just a, you know, like a four years old, jumping up and playing at his feet, and then jumping up and crawling up on his lap and hugging him around his neck. And he just let me, you know, he just let me love him and everything like that. And it was like, oh, I get it. Childish innocence. We know nothing except the love. And that's what we're supposed to see. And if we can just get a hold of that love, it takes care of everything else. It's kind of like the Ten Commandments that Jesus said in the New Blood Covenant that we have with him, that to do one and two, and the rest of them will take care of themselves. You know, love your God with all your heart and all your mind, everything you have, and love your neighbor as yourself. And the rest of them, all the laws, all the prophets hang on the rest of it, and they're all taken care of already. We only have to do those two. Well, that's not hard. That really isn't hard if that's what you get set your mind to do, you know?
Anyway, just lay down your life.
There you go, every day, on a daily basis, moment by moment.
And that's where the Holy Spirit comes in, because I can't do it. My flesh is weak.
That's right.
My heart fails.
I can't do it either.
And where we're weak, he's strong, you know? He carries us through because he's our strength. I kind of like
that. You want me to share the next one, too?
Yes, do it. I'm sorry.
What? Yeah, you want me to go right ahead. Yeah.
Okay. So the next one was, I believe the healing power of God to be, and the Lord put on my heart a witness to reveal himself.
Ooh, I like that. I like it.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So in Matthew 11, it says, when John heard in prison that Christ was doing what he was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, are you the one who was to come and should we expect someone else? So Jesus replied, go and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, those who have leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is preached to the poor. Blessed is the man that does not fall away on account of me. Mm-hmm. So that was one scripture. And I thought, wow, that does show the witness mm-hmm. of Christ. And then on John 10, 37 and 38, he says, how then can you accuse me of blasphemy for stating that I am the Son of God? If I am not doing the works of my Father, then do not believe me. But if I am doing them, even though you do not believe me, believe the works themselves, so that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I am in him.
That's wonderful.
That's awesome. That was perfect. Thank you very much.
I thought it was really
great.
We've had somebody chime in just a second. We have had someone write in. Thank you. And this is the question. Are you ready, ladies? Drum roll. How do I go about seeing healing power when I'm in constant pain? Hello?
Well, we started out with communion. We started out with communion, partaking of the body of Christ and the blood of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
And, see if that alleviates your pain a little bit. We started out with this, and then we talked about the word, imparting the impartation of the word. I don't know if this hearer that called in, if she wants to, elaborate a little bit more, if she's been in the word or things that she has done for her healing.
No, she's writing right now, so hang on just a second. She's a born-again Christian. She has terminal illness, so she's got a death sentence. And she has been in the Word, and she has other ministry. She didn't give the name of it, but she has ministry healing tapes and things that she listens to, and yet she doesn't seem to be able to get away from the pain.
Okay.
Well, you're talking about the healing power of God, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the healing power of God says that we don't have to have pain and suffering. Did somebody say something to me?
No, I didn't say anything. Go ahead.
Oh, that we don't have to have pain and suffering because Jesus took it at the cross. And you remember that. I will say this. In healing, because I have a healing ministry, and in healing, I have found that you cannot just read the healing scriptures and you can, I shouldn't say it that way. You need instruction. You need to go to your pastor or to someone that you believe understands the word of God. And I'm glad to see that you're here tonight, because we do. And maybe we can help you. But you have to understand, like, who you are. When you're born again, you were born, like I was saying earlier, you're born through Christ Jesus. So now you're a new creation in Christ Jesus. You've got a complete new slate. So that death sentence is gone. It's under the blood. It's gone. And you're healed. You're made whole. Jesus did that for you at the cross. So here's the thing. You need to get a hold of that. You need to understand that you have been healed already. It's already done. So what's your expectation level? Are you expecting to see the healing power of God operate in your life? Are you expecting when you go to the doctor to have him tell you that you're better? Are you expecting to have pain and suffering? Because what do you believe? The bottom line is, what do you believe? And do you really believe it? I mean, you can say, oh, yes, I believe that I'm healed, and yet you're not. Maybe you're connected just in your head. Your intellect's connected, but your heart's not hooked to it. If you don't have a head and heart connection over it, if you don't understand the word of God, it won't come alive to you. It'll just be words on a page. So you need to understand that, A, Jesus took that at the cross. He took all sickness, all disease, all terminal illness, so that we, none of us, would ever have to have it. Because he took everything from here to the end of the age, to the end of when he comes again, in all sickness, all disease, so that any that we would ever know. So he's already got what you got. He took it. Give it back to him. The enemy's giving you lying symptoms, and I know that you're going to say, oh, yeah, right, because I'm in pain. Yes, I know. But that is a lying symptom. What happens is, when you come into agreement with the enemy and what he's saying about you, then you're taking it. What does the word of God say about you? He says that he took all your sickness and disease at the cross. You are made whole. You were made whole at the cross. You were healed then. So you're healed now. By his stripes you were healed and still are. You can't get rid of it. It's yours. You're born again. So you can't undo it. So you've got it. Now just come into realization of it. Come in alignment with it. Align your heart and your mind with the word and stay in that. And when the enemy gives you a twinge, tell him that he doesn't have anything in you, that you were healed at the cross. As Jesus is, so am I in this world. How is he? I just said it a little while ago, and maybe you weren't with us then, but as Jesus is, he is perfect. He is divine health and wholeness, and he's in you, wrapped around your DNA spirals as his. If they could take our cell, a cell of our body, and see our DNA and be able to see Jesus's DNA, it would be in every single cell of our bodies. We were immortal to begin with. Adam gave it away, and Jesus gave us back our immortality. We're just down here waiting for our new glorified bodies. That's all. When we were born again, we died to self, we died to Christ, we died already, and we have been born again. We are now resurrected. We are full of the resurrection power of God, and all we need is for Jesus to come again. And what happens to us? That resurrection power pulls us right up into the sky to meet with him. So you don't have to have pain, you don't have to have suffering, but what do you believe? Do you believe it? If you still have pain and suffering and you're reading the scriptures and you're going through all the motions and nothing's happening, then you're just going through the motions. So what do you believe? Oh, and what do you expect?
I have something to share with
you. Okay.
I'm sorry.
No, don't be sorry. That's fine.
It's
okay.
Well, it was just something you said, Steph, mm-hmm. and I interrupted your flow.
No, it's okay.
But you know, when I was thinking of this person and you were speaking of the word and her faith, and I remember one time when I was dealing with these shingles and I got the word before me, my faith felt so weak and puny, and I apologized. Now the word should have been repent, but I apologized to the Lord for my weak and puny faith, mm-hmm. in lieu of the fact that he had paid such a price to bring me not only my healing, but all things. Mm-hmm. And I had those healing scriptures in front of me, but I didn't even feel like reading them. That's how puny my faith was. It was an aggravation to think of reading those scriptures. Mm-hmm. And I heard him whisper to me, faith will come.
Yeah.
See, when you have the word in front of your face, how does mm-hmm. faith come? So I heard his promise whispered in my spirit, mm-hmm. faith will come. So I sat down with my scriptures and I heard the Holy Spirit say, let's join hands together.
Yes.
So do you see we're not left to our own devices? The Holy Spirit has come to our aid, even where that word is concerned. He said, let's join the hands together. And I know I interrupted, but
no, that's
you
okay.
know, sometimes that place where our faith does feel so weak and pruny. But you know, see, he's always there.
Amen.
To lead us through that.
Amen.
And I apologize for interrupting you, Steph.
No, don't say.
That's okay. Mm-hmm. and I want to throw this in here too. I don't know what's causing this lady's pain, but I'm going to share this. I went through a 3-year battle with the big C. And when I first discovered that I had it, fear took over. Mm-hmm. I wasn't afraid of dying in the sense that I was going to be in heaven, because I knew that, but fear of the pain, right? Fear of all the things I'd been told went with having that, not knowing, the unknown, fear of the unknown. So if whoever you are is experiencing pain on an everyday type of basis, which I'm sure you are, then maybe if you start to refuse, I'm not going to say maybe, I know from experience, the minute you start refusing fear, I am not afraid because I am not alone. I don't get it, God. I don't get it. I read the scriptures, but I don't get it. Truthfully, my sister stood over me and she read 50, we had, I think, 62 scriptures written down. And they were all just healing scriptures, one right after another, and she read them to me out loud over and over. And then she said, all right, start forming the words with your mouth, read them off the page with me as I do it. And I did. I didn't want to. I honestly didn't want to. But in my heart, as a born-again person, I know that what God's word says is truth. It is, there's no falsehood in it, it's truth. So if you go through the motions, just keep going through the motions, because as Joanna was mentioning, faith will come by hearing it, by opening your mouth and letting it come out. I don't care if it's out loud. If you just start mouthing it so that your mind works and your heart starts working together, the repetition is what brought me through it. It pulled me, continually pulled me, repeating it till I was sick of hearing it, but I heard it anyway. And it went in my ear and it went in my heart. Pretty soon it was coming out, I'm healed. I heard myself thinking it even. I don't have this. I don't have to have this. I'm not afraid of it anymore. I don't have it. I don't care what the doctor says, what the scientist portion, the medical portion, I am not having this. I am not going to die from something evil. I'm not doing it. Mm-hmm. So pretty soon it just started building my spirit up. But it took days. I mean, she did that for 9 days straight. And it was pretty close to 24 hours a day. Once in a while she'd fall asleep and I'd be awake, and so I'd read them.
Tiffany, did you have pain? Was your pain alleviated by
I didn't have any pain. I had no pain. Honestly, I had fear of it, but I didn't have any of it. So I'm hearing this lady, but I don't totally relate because I don't have pain. However, as a symptom of, or let's see, not a symptom, one of the things that happens to you when you go through chemotherapy and radiation are breakdowns of your nervous system. And as a result of that, I now have had, I don't right now, and I'm going to tell you about that, but for the last 2.5 years, I've had a neuropathy in my feet to where I didn't know, sometimes if I stood up, I couldn't feel anything. I didn't know whether I was standing up or not, except for the fact that I'm looking at myself standing up. There was no feeling in my feet. So I had to force myself out of habit to walk. And I don't mean I walked around and, limped or anything like that. I walked normally, but it was out of pure will and stubbornness because I had no feeling in it. And I prayed every day, I am the righteousness of Christ Jesus. I have feeling in my feet. Thank you very much. Every single day I would get up and say that. About 2 or 3 weeks before I came down here to visit my daughter, and I was at my home in Washington, I'm going up and down the stairs, and I was carrying firewood up about 15 steps to the main floor. And I had two logs, not big ones, but I would have like kind of hold them in my arms around them, and just a little bit with one hand that I could hold the rail so I could go up and down those stairs, because I had to think, pick your foot up, put it on the step, pick your foot up, put it on the step. And I know that sounds completely lunaticky, but that's exactly what I had to do because I had no feeling. When I got to about halfway up the staircase, so I'm going to say about 8 steps, I heard this like pop. I don't even know how to explain it. It wasn't loud, but I heard it in my head. The next step I took, I had complete and total feeling in both my feet. Praise it was God. Like instant miracle.
Praise the Lord.
Instant. Mm-hmm. I practically ran up those stairs because I was so excited about, I could feel, oh my gosh, I can, I was waiting for the other foot to drop for fear I wasn't feeling truth. Mm-hmm. But in truth it was, but it took time. And refusing in the face of that enemy, I am refusing this. You can think what you want, creep. I am not having it. I have Jesus and I have him forever. And And I read the healing scriptures at night sometimes before I went to bed. Sometimes, no, keyword, sometimes. To constantly remind me. But the real reminder of the truth was that communion every day. When my girlfriend would call and we'd go through, oh, no, I don't feel any better today. I still can't feel my feet or whatever. And she'd talk about whatever was bugging her. Sometimes it was just good stuff. Other times it was icky. But that communion brought that intimacy inside, like you were talking about being in an internal thing. That external movement of putting it inside and getting close to Jesus, sitting at the throne room at the foot of the Father. I did it. It was a repetition. So whomever you are, I can only tell you from my own personal experience that he is real. Mm-hmm. If you don't give up, never give up. Just keep going. Press on. Press forward, for the reward is there.
Amen.
It will happen for you. It will happen for you. When you can't hold your arms up anymore, you can call any one of us, and we will stand beside you and hold behind you and hold your arms up in praise to God and thank him for it having already been done until it gets rooted in your spirit, till it gets rooted in there. Each one of us have had some kind of a miraculously moving situation where healing is concerned, and we didn't share all of them yet. We were sharing the concepts of what healing is, the beauty of seeing it in the everyday thing, the beauty of seeing it in physical healing from something, knowing who you are in Christ. I wish it could be simple, because we have been trained from childhood to think in a whole different realm than where we should be. Knowing who you are. I know who my parents were. Yeah, my name is Tiffany. My mom and daddy were so-and-so. I know who I am, but I didn't know who I was in Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And through probably, well, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different types of church denominations it has taken for me to get who Jesus is. Not what he looks to be like on paper, but who he is in here. Inside.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it would be wonderful if it could just miraculously reach down here and go poof, but it doesn't. Once in a while, I guess, when you get the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you'll find that things change instantly for you. That's a whole other story, but that's a healing process too. It's a magnanimous thing. It's a huge sphere of truth. And joy. I guess that's the word I'm looking for. There's healing in joy. So when you look at a newborn child or a little baby in a stroller when you're walking down the street, there is joy and celebration in that. And you feel that. You actually feel it. And as women, of course, we have that mothering, nurturing thing. So we run right over and go, oh, how cute, you know, and it lays there, and maybe it smiles, maybe it doesn't. But we see it, and we see a new creation, and it brings that celebration and joy to our mind and our soul, and we're comforted by it. We feel, ooh, awesome, and, you know, and everything awful around us disappears for a second or two, maybe for an hour, maybe longer. But other things, watching your kid hit a baseball, or holding the hand of somebody that you care about, giving them a kiss,
mm-hmm.
that instant wonderful feeling, kneeling in prayer, being mm-hmm. able to shout, hey, I'm cancer free, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. And know that when somebody walks over to you, you can truthfully say that I'm free of it and share that joy with them. That celebration comes right back to you, because that person is also joyful. They're fearful of whatever awful thing it was, so they're going to share that. And you're going to feel it. It's a healing. It's a presence. It's God's healing power being present around you. Okay, Steph?
Well, yes. You know, our exceeding happiness is something that we have control over. We, we have the ability to employ it, to put it into place and to operate in it. And when we do, we remain in good health. And it says in Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10, then he said to them, go eat of the fat, drink of the sweet, and send portions to him who has nothing prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. We are sustained in our strength by the joy of the Lord. And if we allow the joy to come forward, we can see it in what you're talking about, you know, in the things that we see around us. I always tell all my students and anybody that'll listen to me, look for God in everything. look for God in everything. See Jesus in everything. See the Lord. And you, because we have decay and stuff like this in this world where we are, but there isn't any in heaven. It's all beautiful. So we need to look past the rust and past the chip paint and whatnot and see the beauty of the item. See the beauty in what you're talking about. Just the touch of a hand, you know, or a beautiful rose. I used to sit and look at pansies. We had some in a big tub out on the back porch. And I'd sit there and look at the pansies, and I actually looked at all the different faces. Every single one was unique and different. And I could just sit there and marvel at God and his painting and how he painted everything. Nothing could be as beautiful as what he has done, you know? And that would bring me great joy, but that gives us strength. It gives us perseverance. It gives us hope. And faith, Hebrews says, now faith, meaning right this minute, this faith is instant because God is a God of suddenly. He's a God of right now, not tomorrow or the next day or not the past. Faith is the substantiation, the substance of things hoped for. So if this lady is hoping for healing and praying for healing and believing for healing, then faith opens the door to the supernatural so that God can bring it in and manifest it. So you have hope, you have substantiation of the things hoped for through your faith. And it's the evidence of things not seen, all right? Hope and faith are the evidence of things not seen. And what is that? That's the supernatural, because our reality is truly supernatural. But we think it's here because we can touch it and feel it, and we live by our senses here, which we should not. We should be living for eternity and in the eternal. Okay, go on.
I was just going to ask if we could take a moment and pray for this person.
Yeah, sure, let's do it.
Go right ahead.
Yeah. Father God, we just thank you right now for this heart that's seeking your healing. And we just praise you, Lord, for your willing heart and your most able heart to bring that healing and wholeness, Father. So we do ask and we just declare, Lord, by your stripes, this sweet lady that's seeking healing and wholeness, that she is healed in you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father, for your angels to surround her and minister to her, protect her, Lord, and guide her. Thank you, Father, that the measure of faith that you have given her will increase as she experiences more and more of your great love for her. And I thank you, Lord, that no weapons formed against her will prosper.
That's right.
I thank you, Father, that you are the everlasting God, and that you love this precious daughter with an everlasting love, and that you are with her. Never will you leave or forsake her. And I thank you, Father, that you will guide her step by step by your gracious Holy Spirit, because it's not by might, it's not by power, but it is by your Spirit. So we just thank you, Father, right now for your healing. Mm-hmm. And we thank you for the faith that you are giving her in a greater measure. And we pray just like you did for Peter, that her faith won't fail her, mm-hmm. because you've already prayed it for her. You're her high priest. Yes, it is already done in heaven, because your word is forever settled in heaven. And so we declare right now your healing in the name of Jesus Christ, name above all names. Mm-hmm. Amen.
We thank you, Father, for the healing power of God that we speak into her body right now. It's coursing through her body, coming against everything that is not from you. And we thank you that we see that healing power now going through that body and touching all the cells, all the organs, everything that's affected by this insidiousness that is trying to come upon her. And Father, we thank you that it's cast out. It's gone in Jesus' name. That the healing power of God is coursing through her body on a daily basis, keeping her healed, whole, well, nothing broken, nothing missing in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Father, you gave us the keys to the kingdom of heaven. You said whatever we bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So, Father, I take this authority against all lying spirits. Mm-hmm. In the name of Jesus, I bind all lying spirits, you lying spirit of pain. I bind you and I command you to leave her in the name of Jesus right now. In Jesus' name, loose her. In Jesus' name. And Father, I pray that you bring to her the balm of Gilead to soothe all her aches and all her pains, Lord Jesus. And Father, I thank you that you are our great physician, Lord Jesus, and that we can come to you and utilize your word and speak your word and to cause a change in her environment and in her body. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Boy, there's healing in the room tonight.
Woo! I think that it's important to remind people that you need to just let go and let God transform you into a new person. And change your way of thinking so that the negative things that we see and are subjected to every day can be turned into a positive field of strength and courage so that we have, an empathy for others so that we can see. My biggest thing is I've experienced a lot of stuff, and I want to be able to help somebody understand or know. I guess that's it. I want you to know that I do understand when you have a situation. I think each one of us have had enough experiences in life that when we reach out to somebody or somebody reaches up to us, even if it isn't exactly the same thing, like we haven't had the same exact kind of pain that this lady had, we have an empathy for the experience because we've experienced it in some way or another. And by allowing God, by letting go of all that stuff, just slough it off. Here it is, Lord, take it. Take it back. I don't want it. I don't know how to do it, and I don't want it. So give me that faith that you have. When I don't have it, I want to reach up there and know that you've got that faith to pull me over the top. And letting him do it, it's, you know, we fight it because it's foreign. It's not like I can't reach out there and touch it. It's like the electricity that Karen mentioned earlier. It's there. It's an invisible thing, but it's truly there. And because I can't, it doesn't have skin on it, so I can't reach over and grab it, but it's still there. Okay.
I want to just add something to what you're saying really quickly. This is an addition to what you're saying about that. You see, we're all on a different level of understanding of God's word, every single one of us. We come from different perspectives, different avenues. And that's why we have to recognize that when we are at our wit's end, we do all we can do. We go to where our faith level ends, and we know that that's it. I can't go any farther because I don't have enough faith to believe for an automatic healing or an instant healing or a restoration. But I do have an understanding that if I had an operation, God would see me through it and I would live. That's kind of thing. All right. So when you reach that end of your faith, that's when you take a hold of the faith of Christ, the faith of God, because that's when he brings you up and over. It's like fireworks go off, you know, it's like boom. And then you're up and over before you even realize it. And he's brought you where you need to be. It's his faith we live on. It's his faith that we rely on, because we don't have the faith that it takes. We have barely enough faith as a rule. As we grow, now we're going to grow in Christ, and we're going to grow in that knowledge and that word as we apply it. But until we get there, none of us has what I would call great faith. You know, we might have it for a hangnail. You know, but this is going to go away, and now it's not going to hurt me in Jesus' name, and I'm just going to keep punching it and making sure it doesn't. But we don't have it for the major crises in our lives, like this lady's terminal illness. She's got a death sentence. Somebody gave her a death sentence, you know, and how dare them? God gave us 120 years, and he did it in Genesis chapter 6, verse 3. Is that right? Yes. Anyway, I always get him confused. Anyway, and he said that he wouldn't contend with man forever, and I'm going to paraphrase it, but he would give us 120 years. That came right from God's lips to us. I'm taking that 120 years. Now, Moses went on and he said, well, you know what? Now, he lived to be 120 and he wasn't feeble and his eye wasn't dim, but yet he spoke 70 to 80 years on us. Well, a pox on that. I'm not taking that. I'm taking the 120. That came from God's lips, you know. But anyway, it's because of the understanding of the word that we're on.
Hmm? What you're saying is if God said it,
that settles
so.
That's
and
right.
Jesus came and said, it is so. He showed it. He demonstrated it. And it's hard to, and what you said is when we start looking at the seen instead of the unseen, mm-hmm. we're looking at the temporal instead of the eternal. Mm-hmm. And it's hard to separate sometimes that what's really happening, because it's real. It feels, and because it is in your reality, but it's stepping into that place of intimacy with mm-hmm. the Lord, climbing on his lap with that childlike faith and saying, Daddy, I need you.
That's right.
I need you. And that's that intimacy. And when you start even saying his word, like you can make it kind of fun, uh-huh. you know, instead of a drudgery. I'm sorry, but I've never had to go through cancer. Thank you, Jesus. And but I've seen my sister go through mm-hmm. it, and I've had loss in my family, but you know, taking the word of God, I wasn't there yet.
Yeah.
Putting that aside, what I was going at was taking the word of God, and you can make it, you know, versatile. Do it with song, do mm-hmm. it with praise and thanksgiving, change it up. Don't let it be a drudgery, you know, mm-hmm. go into it little steps at a time. Like you're eating all day long, 2 or 3 scriptures a day. It doesn't have to be 64 scriptures in 1 hour, you know, do it like you're, as if you're eating all day long, you're feeding it like you're taking medicine in, and it's, you're believing it as a healing word, and you're taking it like medicine mm-hmm, and you're mm-hmm. letting God yeah. go in and it, like the communion, it's an inner healing, but you're also renewing your mind because the enemy yes. wants you to think that you're done.
That's right.
But God says no.
That's right.
It's his your days are ordained in his book, and then he says your first and your last breath are in his hand.
That's right.
So just keep committing your days into his hands, and he'll guide you the rest of the way.
I love what you said. I wrote it down. God said it, and Jesus demonstrated it. Oh, hallelujah. That's so true. That was great. Yes. Amen.
It's kind of like looking at a tightrope. It's your faith, you know. It's mm-hmm. like a tightrope.
It is.
You know, there's days where you feel like you're on a high hill, and other days you're on a very thin rope.
You're hanging on.
Barely hanging on. But honestly, I think that you, spending your time with the Lord and just letting him love on you and love on you and love on you. Now, with me, I've had a broken heart. Mm-hmm. And you think that that's never going to get ever healed. But one day, just all of a sudden, the Lord just shows up.
Yeah.
And hugs on you and loves on you, and he mends that broken piece in your heart. And he said, I come to heal the broken, to be near the brokenhearted, and to mend them and to make mm-hmm. them better and whole. And that's who Jesus is. He's God, and he's perfect in every
marvelous.
Way.
Marvelous.
I don't want to run over our
no,
time.
No, you're all right.
We've got a little bit of time. But we have, we've covered a lot of various things here. And the one thing that came up a couple of times, but not to the extent that I wanted to save it to the end, is the one healing, major healing power thing that we have overlooked a little bit. We haven't emphasized much, and I already had told you you couldn't because I wanted to save it for last. And that is, ta-da,
love.
Love. Exactly. Love. The healing power of God's love. And I know I've experienced it, and from just talking to Joanna, she's experienced it repeatedly. Mm-hmm. Sharon, you have repeatedly felt it. You see it, you walk it, you eat it, you know it's there. And I know that Karen does too. She works in it every day with people who need that love, and she counsels with them and moves them through a space of darkness into the light of the love of God. And that is the healing power in every, I mean, there's no other word to put in it except the ultimate healing power of God is his love, his willingness to do it, to make that sacrifice, his willingness to share it, to lay it on us so much that we want to share it ourselves because we're in these pursuits down here, you know, working through. And you have anything there to add, Steph?
Yeah. One of the things is, I have a couple things, but one of the things that you put me in mind of when you were talking there is this. You know, we started out as in the essence of God. We were in his mind and his heart, and he created us from clay and mud and earth material, and then breathed his breath into us and gave us life. And it with that life, because it was God's breath, came that resurrection power that he gave to Jesus Christ, and Jesus came down to demonstrate to us. Now, if you think about it, he brought us here, and then when Adam made a mistake and ruined everything for us, he actually redeemed us immediately, put that plan into action, and he brought us back on a search, and our hearts cry out, and we're yearning for him, and he brings us back to the door, to his son, Jesus the Christ, and when we accept him, we're back in his presence, we're back in with him again. And it's just a wonderful cycle that God does for us, and it's because he loves us, and it was his love that is so intense. I mean, like I said before, if you could just get a hold of how much he loves you, it would just absolutely fry your brain because you couldn't contain it. You just couldn't. But because of God's love for us, he wants us well and whole. To tie this to healing, he wants us to be back like we were created, to be immortal the way he created us. He created us to never be sick, to never die. Our evidence is our bodies. Look at, they heal themselves. You cut yourself, you don't have to tell your body how to mend itself. It starts healing. And because why? Because it's full of the glory of God, full of the resurrection power of God. Now, we have been given eternal life, and we get that eternal life when we're at the new birth. In other words, when we are born again, we are born through Jesus Christ, and now we have his healing, his power, his attributes, his perfection are all restored to us as part and parcel of us. Remember, we were made in the image and the likeness of God. That's God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We too, are a triune being, spirit, mind, and body. You know, so we are made in the replication of, we're a little bit lower, you know, small g. But we are given all these attributes, and we don't know it because our minds come into this world when we're born with a sack over our head, kind of. I mean, that's my analogy of it, where we are blinded by the curse, and we are groping around in the dark, waiting and finding our way through the maze until we encounter the door, Jesus. And he says, come here, come into me. I'll save you. I'll lift you up. I'll restore you back to the Father where you can have that perfect life in the Garden of Eden. Where's the Garden of Eden? It's in us. When we're born again, it's inside of us. Now we are busy doing and getting about our Father's business. We're busy doing his work, what he has given us to do. And each of us comes with something, not just a calling, but something that God has specially given to us, a talent that we're supposed to exhibit. Do you know how many people go home to be with the Lord and never exhibit that talent? They don't know they have it. You know, we're missing it. We're missing it greatly because we don't understand. We lack understanding. And that's what he says. My people perish for lack of knowledge. We don't understand. And all of you are getting good understanding. That's what he says. And there's a reason for that. You know, I don't know about everybody else. I can only speak for myself. But I love the Lord. And I told the Lord one time, God, I'm talking about God the Father. I said, I want to know everything that you know. I want to know what makes you tick. I want to climb up into your mind and tell me everything. I want to know what you have for me, and I want to do it now. I don't want to wait till I get to heaven because I won't need it then. I want it now. Everything you have for me. I want your wisdom, not Solomon's. Solomon was the wisest man on earth. I want to be bearing your wisdom, you know. And I have to tell you that God showed me his love in many, many ways, over and over again, every day, in small ways. We overlook the small miracles. Everything that happens to us is a miracle. We got up. God wakes us up in the morning, gives us another chance to go out and do it again. And this time get it right, you know, or reach out to somebody and lift them up along the way. We just got to do it. If we do that, we're exhibiting the love of God. He fills us up to overflowing. And then we're supposed to overflow with the love out to others, the people that are in our circle of influence. Who are those people? The people you come in contact with on a daily basis, your family, then your friends, the people at work. Are you loving them or are you maligning them, backbiting, talking about them at the water cooler behind their back? You know, what are you doing? Do your part. If you show your love of God, the love of Christ, through you back to the people that surround you, then you're doing your job, you know? And what's going to happen? We're going to see a chain reaction. When all of us born-again believers begin to do that, we're going to take over the world because love always never fails. You know, it never fails. Okay? Okay. The end. Somebody else can talk. Blah, blah, blah.
All right. Well, I can sum up then what we've covered tonight in, a whole lot of words, but I think the one that stuck out the most to me was being a witness to reveal himself. Mm-hmm. That is a precious healing power that we accept who Jesus is. It becomes a witness to reveal himself to us. And because we are to follow in his footsteps, then we are to become a witness also to others to reveal him to them, because he uses people. He uses good people, and good comes out of bad too. You can make lemonade out of lemons. So, if we start letting God change our way of thinking to where we see goodness, we see kindness, we see the beauty of the miracles of God everywhere, in the rose and the flower and the bird, in that guy's pair of tennis shoes and how cool they are, and gosh, I want some, in all the creations that he has given us the knowledge to do. If we look at those, we will see the healing power of God, because everything, the joy, then will take over. And that is your strength. His love will start blooming in front of you, and it'll multiply, and it will come through you to others, so that they, sometimes the only Jesus a person sees is what comes from us, and how we react to a situation, what we say, whether we condemn somebody or make a decision about to judge what they are doing or what they're thinking. If we actually allow that healing power that's encompassed in love and in kindness, and we revert to the scriptures that say, I want to read it because finally, if you think upon these things, whatsoever things that are good, whatsoever things that are true, whatsoever things that are honest, whatsoever things that are just, whatsoever things that are pure, whatsoever things that are lovely, whatsoever things are of a good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Look past the ugly to the healing power that is given to us by looking at those things and seeing them, because that healing power not only heals our heart and our inner person, it heals someone else too. And I think that's pretty much all I've got to say for tonight. I know we're going to carry this over next
yeah.
week as well. And we're going to get into some really heavy stuff next week. Tonight was just kind of a skim over the top. And here we are so that we can understand where we're going. Yeah.
Next week, I would like to see us tackle the methodology. I'd like to speak on that, if we can, if you want to add that to your curriculum. Tiff's going to take this again next week since this is her topic, but I just wanted to insert that. I thought if we could discuss some methodologies of application of the healing power of God, what to expect and how to see it operate in our lives, so we know what to expect. If we go in with expectation, we'll come out with something, you know? So if we can add that to our topic list.
Okay.
And I was saying, I'm sorry, I didn't want to ask anymore.
Actually, all I was going to say is there anybody else that has comment?
Well,
go ahead.
I was thinking about what a Tiff was reading in Philippians 4 about what to keep our minds on and how important that is now with all the ugliness just increasing around about us. How important that is. And of course, you know, we've been stressing love this evening. And of course, love is the first fruit of the Spirit that all the
yes.
others hang on. And then the last one, discipline, holds it together. But, you know, if we would walk in that love and with that mindset that Tip was saying, then you see there's our witness there because we'll be a living, walking epistle. You know, what? How does it say? Written in the word, we're written epistles.
Yes.
So then when we're out and about, you know, it doesn't even take an effort to be a witness. It comes up, bubbling up out and through it.
Mm-hmm.
From out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth is going to speak. And there's your witness. You are the witness.
Yes.
And you know, you can see the joy on people's face because we are so uniquely made. So however the Lord created us, that is what is going to ooze from us as we're about and in contact with others. You can see your gifts. You can see your gifts in operation,
mm-hmm.
bubbling through you, and you know how it delights the Lord. What a
yes.
delight we are to the Lord when we're in this process.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, that's what I was thinking, and I wanted to know what happened to Karen tonight because I hardly heard her say anything.
And you know what? That's more than what I usually say. What I said tonight, I was just going to say the woman that had cancer, make sure that she comes out of agreement with the evil report,
mm-hmm.
and reads, Pastor, you were talking about, Pastor Stephanie, you were talking about living to 120 and let her hopefully come into agreement with that
yes,
verse and
amen.
Get that down in her heart.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'd like to hear from her again.
I
to
would too.
See how she's doing.
Yeah, me too. I'm
yeah.
thrilled that she bothered to contact us, and we're going to invite her right now to keep coming back and letting us walk you through this with our Bible study, even to help you gain momentum and overcome the evil that's been perpetrated on you by the enemy. So we want to change your heart, change your mind, and help you. And if you'll come back, then we will be happy to do so. Amen.
Love on you.
Mm-hmm.
just to go off of what you were saying, Tiffany, what kind of popped out at me the most was what Joanna brought up tonight was the healing power of God's word. Because it is forever settled in heaven. Without his word, where there is no healing. I mean, like, it's alive, it's active, and it cuts through all the deceptions. It cuts
mm-hmm.
through all the lies. It's the spirit of truth.
Mm-hmm.
It's the sword of the spirit. And I've not experienced physical healings where maybe some of you ladies have. But I've experienced in the ministry that I'm in, where Jesus, the people encounter Jesus in such a way that they're set free from emotional bondages, unforgiveness, bitterness, resentment, wounds, traumas that were done against them that kept them kind of in an emotional arrest. Mm-hmm. So with coming in among them and being around them and ministering to them and revealing the lie and bringing forth the truth, which is the word of God,
yes,
there's healing. They are encountering the Lord, and there's healing. And so that's the word of God is, you know, where Psalms one, I think it's 119, where I love your word, you know, and it, you know, I hide it in my heart,
yes,
so I won't sin against you. And it's a lamp to my feet, and it's a light to my path.
Mm-hmm.
His word is it's life. It's
yes,
the bread of life. It's Jesus.
Amen.
And remember the centurion said, Lord, the Lord wanted to come to his house to heal his servant. And he said, Lord, just speak the word. You don't even need to come.
Yeah.
And my servant will be healed.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's how powerful the word of God is.
Amen.
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 Love your word, Lord.
Yeah, me too. Me three, me five.
We love your word, Lord.
Well, next week we'll continue addressing this topic and share the depth of the Word of God on it. And Tiff will give us some stuff after we close out, so that some direction, I think. Maybe she'll send it to us, but we need it before 2 or 3 days from now, so we have time to really work on it. And we're going to continue leading, she's going to continue leading us on this subject, and we're going to delve into it next week. Thank you for joining us. We look forward to you joining us again next week. And we'll be right here as we study God's word on the Bible Study Online. God bless you all and have a wonderful evening.